Hey, hello everyone, and good evening. My name is Sarah Pate, and I would like to welcome you on behalf of the Washington Center for the Book, an affiliate of the Library of Congress Center for the Book, and a partnership between the Washington State Library and the Seattle Public Library. The Washington Center for the Book promotes literacy and a love of books, reading, and libraries. We celebrate Washington's robust literary heritage and shine a spotlight on the contributions of reading and libraries in strengthening communities and in fostering civic engagement. One of our projects is the Washington State Book Awards. We are thrilled to have you here tonight with us for another event in our series to celebrate the 2021 Washington State Book Award winners. Our next event, an interview with Jennifer K. Mann, author of The Camping Trip, by North Mason Timberland Regional Library Youth Service Librarian Erica Miller, will be released on February 8th at 10 a.m. We will put the link for that event and our other confirmed events in the series in the chat after this intro and interview. We'd also like to thank our event partner for tonight and for this entire series, the Washington Library Association. I'd like to welcome Brianna Hoffman, WLA Executive Director, to say a few words.
Thank you, Sarah. Since 1931, the Washington Library Association has been a leader in the Washington library community, providing advocacy, professional development, and leadership opportunities to our members, while also promoting intellectual freedom and innovation. We are so excited and honored to be partnering with our friends, the Washington Center for the Book, for this center series of events. On behalf of WLA, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Now back to Sarah to kick off our program.
Thank you, Brianna. As you have questions for Jennifer Haupt this evening, please put them in the Q&A section or the chat so that we can help facilitating getting your questions to her when the Q&A begins. So, in addition to editing and curating Alone Together, Jennifer Haupt is the author of the novels In the Shadow of 10,000 Hills and Come As You Are, which will be published in March of 2022. Jennifer's essays and articles have been published in O, Oprah Magazine, Psychology Today, The Rumpus, and many other publications during the past 25 years. She also teaches writing workshops at the Hugo House. Jennifer, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. Oh, and you're muted, Jennifer.
Unmute. Thank you so much, Sarah. And thanks to Washington Center for the Book and to librarians for supporting this book so much.
So I want to thank you for editing and pulling together this beautiful collection. And I'm wondering if you could start by telling us a little bit about the genesis of this project. How did it come together? When did the idea strike? And how did you go about making it a reality?
It seems so long ago now, right? And it's so thinking back, it's just incredible to think back to that time when I felt so just not only alone and kind of scared about what was going on, but also powerless. And I have a lot of friends who are writers and readers and booksellers. And I thought, you know, there has to be some way we can all get together and do something positive during this time when it seems almost like futile to even write a novel it seemed like nothing creative I was doing mattered. And I felt like a lot of other authors felt the same way. And I remembered receiving actually an email from Garth Stein, who was asking people to donate to Bink. And I thought, well, that would be an awesome organization to come together as readers and writers and help support. So it sort of snowballed, and I started by interviewing a couple of authors. And then I kind of thought about the shape of the book and what kind of essays I might want in the book and what kind of poetry. And it just kind of came together. And every day there were pieces that came into my inbox that just made me hopeful. And I thought, well, this is going to make other people feel hopeful too.
And did you already know all of the authors, or was it sort of kind of a web that spun out from your contacts that you started to make?
It was definitely a web that spun out. I've got a blog that I do for Psychology Today called One True Thing, where I interview authors. And so I knew, I started with some of the authors I had become friendly with over the years, Danny Shapiro and Caroline Levitt, Gina Frangelo, and some other people. And then I started thinking about you know, who deserves, not deserves, but who should have a voice in this book. You know, it can't just be people that I know and people who are my friends. It there needs to be, you know, I need to spread a wider net. And so some of the people who were included in the book helped me to connect with other people, and it grew into something bigger and broader, which I feel really good about.
Thank you. So relatively speaking, this project came out pretty early in the pandemic, in September of 2020, really just about 6 months in. As the pandemic has progressed, how have your methods of coping, grieving, and finding comfort changed? And have your writing habits and your writing changed?
Wow, that's a really good question. I was really glad I had this book to focus on for about the first 6 months of the pandemic, because I really just couldn't get into writing. I was in the middle of writing one novel. I had another novel that was supposed to be coming out, and the publication date was put off indefinitely because of the economic environment. And so now I'm back to pretty much back to my normal writing habits of trying to write every day for a couple hours in the morning, a couple hours in the afternoon. And I think that staying creative actually is a really good coping strategy during times of isolation and difficulty.
And can you talk a little bit about just the sort of miraculous speed in which this all came together, and how that happened, how your publisher helped with that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I had never put together an anthology before, and I actually didn't realize how difficult it would be. And and I think that's kind of probably good, because, and my publisher was amazing in just saying, you know, guiding me in terms of, this is going to be a lot of work, it's going to be a difficult process, but it's something we can do. And just, I give her all the credit in the world, Michelle Hellcat at Central Avenue Publishing, for taking this on and saying, you know, even though it's a horrible publishing economic environment, we need to do something to give back and help independent booksellers who have helped authors so much over the years. So definitely Michelle, definitely all the authors involved were so, I can't believe the speed at which people developed new work, like totally new work, and the quality of things that came in, because most of the work in here is new work, and it hasn't been published elsewhere. So really, I think everyone who contributed to the book, as well as my publisher, as well as there's so many people who just came together to get this out.
A related question that just came in from the audience is, what organization did you say that Garth was asking for support for? Can you spell up?
Sure, it's BINC. It's and now I'm blanking on the acronym, but it's an organization that supports independent booksellers nationwide. And so booksellers, if they're in trouble, they can request a grant from BINC and you know, to get them through rough times.
Thank you. So being as we're asking from the center for the book, I've got to ask you, what role have libraries played in your life as an author, as an editor, and also I know as a journalist as well?
Well, I actually am old enough where I remember when there was no internet and you had to go to the library to research things. And so my earliest memories of actually, you know, when I began writing for magazines and newspapers like a million years ago, I would actually go to the library and, you know, look at microfiche and ask the librarian to help me figure out where things were. And so I spent a lot of time in the library in the early part of my career. And libraries have always been a respite for me to, you know, when the kids are young and I needed to go someplace else and just get some quiet time, going to the library has always been, you know, for me, a real respite. And librarians have just been wonderful in supporting my first novel and supporting Alone Together. And I just, I feel like it's just being part of the literary community as a reader and as a writer, along with librarians and booksellers, is really, really a pleasure.
Thank you. Can you tell us anything about the projects that you are currently working on?
I've got a book coming out in March that it's called Come As You Are, and that's another novel. It's my second novel, and it takes place partially in Seattle music scene of the early 90s. So it's kind of, it's got a fun backdrop to it. And then I'm also working on a book that is autobiographical novel that takes place in Haiti that I've been working on for about 10 years. And it's about, it's about the vanity shadow of altruism. And so that's kind of my big project I'm working on.
Thank you, exciting. So before we play the video of a number of the contributors we're gonna queue up next, could you tell us a little bit about the audiobook of Alone Together and how that happened? And
Let's see, so, yeah, I mean, I am really thrilled that it did happen. I can't say a lot about it because I don't know a lot about it, to tell you that God's honest truth, except that I'm thrilled that it happened.
Perfect. I know that a lot of times authors don't have a lot of control over the, it's kind of like the book cover and the, who narrates a book. So it's fascinating to hear.
The book cover, actually, I love the book cover. My editor and publisher designed it, and it's just, it so encapsulates the whole pandemic time of all of us being separate, but coming together also. And so that I can speak to. I think it's an amazing cover.
It is a beautiful cover. Okay, so before we share the video, do you want to let the audience know anything about it?
Yeah, so it's 19 of the, I think it's 29 authors from Washington State who are each reading a section of their poem or their essay. And I really feel like this award belongs to all 99 authors who contributed, but in particular, the Washington State authors, because it's the Washington Book Award. And I feel so blessed to be part of the literary community in Seattle and in Washington State, because we have so many amazing authors and it's a very supportive community. I couldn't have done this book without the literary community, in Seattle and Washington State, as well as my community of authors. I know, nationwide, but in particular, the literary community of Seattle. So
wonderful. Thank you so much. Hannah, please go ahead and share the video.
Civilization begins with art, with the need to represent one's culture in a metaphysical way. A charcoal drawing in a cave in France, perhaps. Music, drums, and dancing after a feast. Public discussions and criticisms of a poem, a song, a story, a movement. A written testimony of an individual's life. Because art reflects the human experience better than any act of sustenance or preservation. An urban center is just a crowded agora until a can of spray paint finds itself in the hands of a disenchanted youth. Then an urban center becomes a means of expression.
This is Kelly Russell Agadon, and reading my poem, I Kind of Want to Love the World, but I Have No Idea How to Hold It, co-authored by Melissa Steddard and me, for Alone Together. I kind of want to love the world, but I have no idea how to hold it. I'm dazed already. I'm over-chocolated and writing poems to a universe that keeps wrapping its constellations around my waist, wrapping its tragedies around the necks of entire planets. I've seen hungers so desperate they can never be filled. Stray children, stray dogs, my stray self. I try to hold it all, stuffed more and more in until my container broke. Skin and glass everywhere, little shards of me on the floor, mixed with everyone and everything else that is broken. Mixed too with the tragic, beautiful worlds that spilled out like secret eggs from which I was certain some lovely winged creature would emerge. Thank you.
I'm lying flat on my back in a tent in my yard, built for six people. With the rain fly, it covers the flagstone patio that we installed when we couldn't imagine wanting a lawn. In the quiet of early morning, my husband's phone lights up the cracks in his face. I ask for the time. 3:45, he whispers. I'm awake. There is no acceptable remedy for that truth. It is week six of my family's self-quarantine.
Song at the end of the mind. I think of you as a radio frequency, sometimes hard to find, as I touch this illuminated dial, but tonight you arrive, murmuring into my ear in half sleep. You offer a suitcase of small pleasures and laughter that somersaults its way across the country. In this time of shelter in place, we are fevered wanderers with nothing but an open screen, handheld devices offering luminous ellipses. We heal the earthquaked bones of our pasts, decorating rough mouths with new vocabularies, no longer deferred. As the world quiets, I'm awake to our longings, all that is left to congregate close along the shoreline, unbandaged and unadorned, to listen to the smooth rhythms and cues of quarantine radio. This one goes out to you.
Disaster unpreparedness. Long before this pandemic, long before my daughter tested positive for COVID-19, I was trained in the specter of disaster. I was born in 1953, within a decade of the start of the nuclear age.
The first thing she feels is relief. This thing hasn't caught her off guard at all. She knows how to stay home alone. She's done it before. She's even written about it and put it out there. The world knows she can be alone. The world won't come around knocking.
Dear O, I was born, they said, a boy, into a heritage of paper. If a fire is placed in a crumbling wall, it leads me to you, separated from the screen. I am not here often.
"3 o'clock" by Jenny Shortridge. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? No matter how actively the fight or flight center in your brain wants you to do something, anything. I'm 60 years old and immune compromised. For the hat trick, I live with anxiety disorder, no small challenge in a pandemic. That almond-shaped nut in the center of my brain, called the amygdala, shoots a steady stream of silent alarms into my nervous system. Run for your life. No, wait, fight. No, wait, run?
In the saga of 2020, COVID is cast as the villain, an invisible enemy stalking humanity, closing borders, bankrupting businesses, and killing loved ones. But what if COVID is not the villain, but the antihero, whose heinous actions compel us to listen to the earth, to science, to our bodies, forcing us to stop, to rest, to restore, to heal, and reminding us of our sacred contracts and our soul's purpose, for what changes the soul can also change the world.
Breath by Breath by Logan Blanton. This isn't my first experience with social distancing. At the beginning of 2017, I returned home after living 2 years abroad, the last 8 weeks being in Nepal. I wasn't simply tired, I was exhausted. During the final flight of my 34-hour journey to Orlando, I spent 2 hours in a cramped bathroom, staring at my reflection and splashing cold water in my face, my heart racing. This was the first in a strand of daily panic attacks I would have for 2 months straight, followed by a year of anxiety. Everything I trusted about who I was, my instincts, my optimism, my extroverted nature, would vanish, leaving me unable to recognize the person I saw in the mirror.
Apex Gazing, a record of March 2020. It was the time of late empire, and science and song were all the rage. Chart after nightly chart were rushed to the screen, hieroglyphs better left undeciphered. The news reports a forecast of the magnitude of impending losses, how late we were arriving at our great battle.
Hi, I'm Molly Ringel. Things requiring attention in spring 2020. Whether the fresh air smells cleaner this year, I think it's definitely cleaner, don't you? How to breathe in this mask. Calling my anxiety levels pretty good if I'm able to sleep and if I only have that tight chest feeling a couple of hours during the day. Learning which brilliant planet is shining in the west after sunset lately. Ah, it's Venus. Which battle to pick today with the kids and their at-home assignments? Math? Spanish? Science? Reading? Making myself at least glance at the wills and advance directives my parents emailed to me and my sisters, just to be prepared. They're still healthy, but just in case.
The last t-shirt. I still have the last t-shirt he ever wore, the one he took off before he went to bed, the black one he took off on that Friday night, that July Friday night when the full moon was eclipsed. I see it puddled on the stained tan carpet.
I periodically visit the cemetery where Greg is buried. My ritual is a lot like those from our last day together. I talk to him and cry. I play wistful songs on my phone. I bring him shells and rocks from the beach. I lay in the soft grass with my cheek pressed against his cool headstone. Only now I do all this wearing a mask. Sometimes I look across the cemetery grounds to the chapel, the site of Greg's memorial more than 3 years ago. 100 people stuffed into that overheated sanctuary to share juicy bear hugs, little-known stories about Greg, and deep belly laughs. We sat shoulder to shoulder in the pews, passing programs and tissues and cups of water. My brother-in-law, who officiated, clasped hands with each person who stepped to the podium to speak. When the slideshow of photos grew too much for me to bear, my mother locked elbows with me and my sister interlaced her fingers with mine, anchoring my body to the pew.
Deeper than social connections. We span two generations and three continents. We were connected in the fall of 2019, at first only by a 5 foot something Spitfire who collected us individually across the vast Twitter sphere. We accepted our invitations, hungry for knowledge and support in the ego-bruising process of becoming published authors. Each of us had navigated to the unicorn of social media, hashtag writing community. It is a commonplace stand-up if you're looking for tips on the craft, blind encouragement to vanquish the terror of a block, or a question to incite reflection. It is rare, though, for one person to find 11 other people, among them billions, and develop a deep enough connection that not a day goes by without communication for 7 months and counting. We all dipped our toes in the waters of connection tentatively. We talked about writing. We represented a wide range of genres and modalities, poetry, prose, and screenplay, historical fiction, romance, young adult, suspense, women fiction. We had it all. We organized and supported a round of pitching events on Twitter, and like caterpillars metamorphosizing into butterflies, our gifts emerge.
The House with the Mossy Roof by Abigail Carter. I walked my dog Chloe toward the house two doors down, the one with the mossy roof that we have passed nearly every day since moving to the neighborhood 3 years ago. I stopped at the driveway as Chloe sniffed a shrub, imagining myself climbing the crumbling steps, gripping the tilted iron railing, and knocking on the door.
Hi, my name's Greg Colucci. This is my COVID-19 story. My building needs supplies for COVID-19. We need masks, hand sanitizer, gloves, cleaning supplies. We're running out, and the management says they're on back order. I tried getting items from Lifelong, but none are available at this time. I live in a 24-unit set-aside building for people living with AIDS. We were the first in the country and maybe even the world to provide housing for this group of people. Now several of us are older and most of us have other health issues. So if we get sick from COVID-19, we will die. While in a panic, I posted this request on Facebook.
On most days at around 4 p.m, Paul and I sit down in the living room with cups of tea and read to each other. It is a new thing. One short story by a different writer each time, one compact saga spun from a singular imagination, one tale of darkness, comedy, or more often, tragicomedy.
Beyond All That, a poem in the voice of the angel Gabriel. I squeeze myself into time. It's tight, like a little coat, or a skin I'm much too big for. I do it, though, for spaciousness, for the light I bring with me.
Thank you so much for putting that video together. Can you tell us a little bit about the process for getting that together for this program?
Actually, it was really easy for me because I just asked everyone to record like 30 seconds to a minute, and then I sent it to my nephew, who's very talented, Daniel Whitworth, and he produced it. He put it all together, and that's about the 10th time I've watched it, and every time I'm just smiling the whole time. I just am so happy with it. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to, you know, to share it.
Definitely. Thank you so much for putting that together for us. And this event tonight is being recorded. And so we'll be able to share it with folks in the future as well who weren't able to be with us live tonight. So we put the link to BINC in the chat. It's the Book Industry Charitable Foundation. But for folks who don't know, could you talk a little bit more about how the proceeds for the book went and continue to go to this organization? Am I correct that that was the intention from the very inception of this book?
Yeah, it was. And so all of the authors contributed their piece for free. I worked for free. My publisher contributed for free. The book distributor, IPG, donated quite a bit of money and time. All of the trade publications like Publishers Weekly and Shelf Awareness and Library Journal did articles and did free advertising. So it was really the whole industry that got together to raise money for BINC. And we've raised over $40,000 so far. And I believe that Michelle, my publisher, donates money every quarter. And so it's something that, you know, they'll, as long as people are buying the books, they'll receive some money for it. Like all the profits from sales go to the booksellers.
That's incredible. Thank you. So a question came in from an audience member. What do you use as inspiration for your writing these days?
Well, we just went to Sedona for 3 days, and that was pretty inspiring. I find a lot of inspiration in nature, particularly trees and rocks and the ocean. And then I'm also inspired by reading. So, you know, it's a lot of different things. And then I find inspiration in meditation. I remember a long time ago, I took a class with Ruth Ozeki, who does a lot with meditation and writing, and it really influenced me. And I try to do some meditation around writing every day.
Nice. A related question that came in from another audience member is, how has the pandemic affected your perspective on creative medium?
Let's see, that's a good question. I'm not sure for me it's really changed that much. I think for visual artists that I know, it's changed their perspective in terms of how they share their art. But for me as a writer, I don't think it's really changed my perspective much, except I would say that doing this anthology has made me think more about using my writing skills to bring people together and to build community in different ways.
Thank you. Okay, next question, another audience question. How does your reading for pleasure vary with your projects? Does it differ if you're writing fiction or nonfiction? Related to that is what you're reading now or recently that you've loved.
Let's see. So I would say that probably, so right now, since I'm writing a book that takes place in Haiti, and I've been to Haiti 3 times, but I've also done a lot of reading about both fiction and nonfiction books that take place in Haiti and the political background in Haiti. So, and I did the same thing when I went to Rwanda. Books for pleasure. Let's see, I've got one that I'm just looking. I'm reading 1, 2, 3 by and I am blanking on her name. Lori, lives in Seattle. You know her. Lori Frankel. So I'm reading that right now. sorry, I blank out when I get nervous. And that's what I'm reading right now. Let's see, I'm reading other things too that I blanked out on. I'm reading Elizabeth Strout's newest book, O William, which I'm enjoying. And I don't think necessarily that what I'm writing affects what I'm reading, but then every once in a while, I'll just find a book that I'm like, this is totally what I needed to read right now for what I'm writing, which is always fun.
Thank you. Let's see, the next question is, we got a comment that came in after your video. It says, your beautiful anthology shares its title with a remarkable list of other books with subjects from anthropology to poetry to trail walking and a few together alone thrown in. And they just wrote after that, vivid. And the next question, it's interesting to me that there are some additional stories in the ebook and audiobook that aren't in the print edition. How did that evolve? And are you aware of that being done much otherwise? Do you have any further commentary on that?
I wanted to include as many authors as possible. And so that's why we did the ebook edition also, because you could only get so many stories packed into the print book. And the print book has a real arc to it. It's like a novel would have. And so the pieces I chose for the print book really go to, you know, the arc of the book. And then there were so many other beautiful poems and essays that were contributed that Michelle suggested doing an ebook version also. So that's how that came about.
Thank you. Another question. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
So I'm not aware of that happening, of any other things like that, but partially that's just because, again, I credit my editor with having a really great vision for this book.
Right, and just the flexibility and speed. It's astounding. Another question's come in. It says, you said you were advised that putting together an anthology would be challenging. What was particularly challenging and rewarding about it? And would you want to work on an anthology again?
What was challenging for me, honestly, was getting a wide diversity of authors, and then figuring out which pieces to include in the book, which didn't fit into the arc of the book. I would say, you know, it was hard for me to, when there was, say, it was hard for me sometimes making those decisions. I wasn't used to being an editor in that way. The amount of speed, the turnaround time was challenging because we really didn't have that much time. That was really challenging. I would say that, but overall it was mostly just a pleasure to work on because there were so many good pieces coming in that were really feeding my soul during that time when I needed that. And so I knew that they would feed other people's souls too.
Do you think you'll take on an anthology again in the future?
Possibly. Yeah, I'm thinking of doing one on a nonprofit basis again. I wouldn't do one if it was something that I was counting on to make money. An anthology would not be my first choice. But it's a really rewarding way as an author and as an editor to bring people together as a community around an issue.
Because of the topic of our event tonight, I do want to share in the chat, the Washington Center for the Book has a project called Sheltered in Place, the COVID-19 Zine Diaries Project. And it's a chance for folks from anywhere in Washington of any age to send in their stories or images, text and or images, either one, or completed zines. And we're putting together an anthology zine, as well as kind of digitizing full zines that come in as well. So I'll share a link to that if anybody is interested in contributing to that. You are more than welcome. And I'll put my email in chat as well if folks have any questions. And we just want to thank you so much for being here with us tonight. I want to congratulate you again on this well-deserved award. And you have any final words for us?
No, just thank you so much. This has really been an honor. And I'm really glad that I could share the montage video that we made and just have a chance to tell people one more time that, you know, if you buy the book, the money does go to support independent booksellers, and make sure you buy it from an independent bookseller. So.
Wonderful. Congratulations again. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.